This talk will be recorded, okay? So it will be available on YouTube. So if you have any problem with the English, because it will be in English, you can go there and see again and stop, pause and play again and so on and so forth. And the basic idea is you can interrupt me and ask questions whenever you want, okay? So the idea is you can ask questions during the presentation, okay? This presentation is, I try to do a kind of summary of several researches we are doing on the our lab concerning the topics of management and analysis of complex networks, focusing specifically in eScience. It was a kind of evolution of a previous talk which we organized it together, me and these four students of my lab for the IBM. And now I did the kind of evolvement of this presentation. And the basic idea is try to put together a perspective, an overview of the research we are doing on our lab, okay? And how they are connected together. And also some open topics. The first thing is, you must understand what we call complex networks, which is not something simple to grasp in the beginning, okay? So the basic idea is, I want to model world things or world phenomena as networks, okay? And there are some kind of networks that you can see or you can imagine in the first look. For example, you can imagine that the roads, the traffic is a network, okay? Because you can see it. If you see a zoom out, you can see a network, okay? And you can imagine that social relations are networks because several people talking about social networks, okay? But there are another networks that they are not simple to get in the beginning. There are, for example, interactions. You can imagine interactions of living beings is a network. And represent the world as networks and study it is something that several researchers in the past and now are concerned. And the first thing is, are these networks randomly wired? Okay, so is the following, or what I call randomly, is could be random-like. When I tell random-like, it's the same thing like, it's so complex that I don't know the elements, but it behaves like a random event. But what is a random event? Let's imagine the following. Social network, so your relations, okay? People you know, people you like, people you are connected, okay? And I can ask you, how do you start some connection with someone, some relationship with someone, okay? How do you do that? Is some random event or something like, okay, I meet someone and if I like this person, I will start some kind of relation with this person. This is the obvious, probably the obvious explanation, right? And so it becomes a network. But if the only thing is some randomly properties of people, okay, probably this network will be random also, right? Because if we have characteristics, they are random. And I will like of your characteristics randomly. So I will like someone, I will not like someone else. What will happen? This network will be random, right? Something like that. Do you understand? Are you following me? The idea of random? Okay. So, the question is, are your social relations random-like? Why? So, if I try to map people you relate, you choose someone just based in these random characteristics. Is this the problem? Is this the question? And these are things people are looking for. Because what is random? The idea of random, I don't know if you know this machine. It's interesting, right? I don't know if you know that. But in the internet, there is some videos of this machine. And you have balls that goes in the top. And they kick on these metal things, okay? And the thing is, there is a probability to kick on it, okay? And there are also a probability when you kick in the first, to kick in the second, and to kick in, and it's not the most of the case you go down, okay? And then sometimes you kick and go right, left, or right. And if you put the balls, you see that they are distributed like that. Why? Because most of the balls will just go down, okay? And then you have balls that goes in the other sides. But this is what we call a normal curve, right? What's a normal curve? Means that things are distributed like that. So we can imagine that if the social relations are random, okay, we can tell, okay, there is a million of persons people relate, usually. Okay, let's say 200. Let's say 200. So there is a million of persons that each people relate, 200. So most of the persons will be in that part of 200, right? And you have the curve telling that some you have less than that, and some you have more than that. But most of the people will be in this average, of relations, which we do 200, right? So this is the basic idea of random-like behavior. Do you think that our relationships are like that? What do you think? Yes, no? Who thinks that they are like that? Raise your hands. Oh, you are thinking there is some kind of trick here or something like that. Yes. And the others think they are not like that. Who thinks that it's not like that? Someone who doesn't know complex networks can tell me why they think they are not like that. Why they are not randomly distributed? They are not randomly distributed, it's true. But why? Someone can tell me? This is an interesting thing. It's not so old discovery, okay? Okay, if you want to see the Gaston machine, is this link. So, to understand why they are not randomly connected, I will tell you about the link prediction problem. The link prediction problem is try to predict what will be the next people we will relate. Let's say it's a Facebook. What is the next people will be a kind of friend? Okay? How can I predict that? Okay. So there are two possible approaches. The first approach is the following. Consider that you have this network, okay? And this network is a network of persons, and these connections are, for example, friend connections or something like that in the Facebook, if you like, okay? And you are a new guy here, okay? Okay, so I want to predict who will do the first connection, okay? Who? Okay, so there are two possible approaches. The first approach is, I select some candidates here. I select some candidates. Could be anyone, but let's select these four candidates to simplify our analysis, okay? There are four guys that I want to know if these candidates will be the guys that you will link, okay? So, consider you don't have any information about these guys. So, we can tell that if we have a network agnostic approach, so we are not considering the network, we are just looking the nodes, okay? You have the same probability to connect to anyone, okay? because we can consider, for example, the case of random attributes and random connections and random distributions. So, for example, there are a possibility, equal possibility, that one of these persons has the characteristics that you relate. So this is network agnostic, okay? But if you see there are nodes there are nodes that have more connections. You agree with me? And other nodes that have less connections. Okay? So they are not all alike. Do you agree? And if you are looking to the connections, okay, who do you think will be the node that this new guy will connect in the first place? Who do you think? Someone want to guess? The green? The green guy? Here? Why? Because he has four friends. Right. But the blue guy also has four. Yes. It seems equal, right? But they are not equal. Because the blue guy is connected with people who is connected with more people. And the green guy is connected with people who is not connected with more people. Just the blue. Okay? So it's not simple like just see how many. Right? But it's, you must look the network. So the blue is also four, but the blue has connections with people who is more connected. Okay? So probably, and we now know that the major probability will be for the blue one. Okay? And this is interesting, and people from social sciences studying that for a long time. Why? Why this guy will connect with this blue guy here? Because he has more connections. And this is something that I'll tell you further, which is the rich get richer. So the one that has more will get much more than the others. So we start talking about complex networks. And what is that? What's the complex network? The idea is the following. Let's see that when you get real-world complex systems, so we are talking not about any network. It's not any. It's not a random network. No. It's networks that reflect complex systems. So we get complex systems in the real world and model them as networks. So we call these networks complex. Okay? And these networks can be seen as a graph. We can look on them as a graph. And they have non-trivial topological features. And this is the thing that I will show you. Because we can look at the network and we can see unusual things that are not usual in this network, and we can study these things. Okay, so the interesting thing is the example I showed in social networks is not only social networks. They behave the same in several networks, like science, nature, technology. They converge much, much more than someone would expect. And this discovery that they behave like that is almost new. 99 is when they really started to convert the things and understand, oh God, we have the same behavior in several kinds of networks. Let's get another example, ecology, which is something that interests me a lot. Ecology is something interesting. So can we model ecology as a network? Of course. So if you want to, you must see this video. I will not show now because it takes a lot of time, but how wolves chant rivers, okay? This is really, really interesting video. You must see it. On YouTube, it's available. And they show there is a region, okay, when the wolves were extinct, okay, in this region. So they reintroduced wolves, just like 4 wolves or 5, just that. But this, the reintroduction, started a network of hidden relations, okay, which started like, since there are wolves, the herbivores will not eat nearby the rivers because they are afraid that the wolves will get them. It's just like 4 wolves. It's not too much wolves. Okay? But they are afraid because could be when they see one, it's, you see? So they stopped to eat nearby the rivers. And for this reason, several plants that stopped to grow in the river started to grow again, okay? And then all the fauna along the river changed because we have more food. And then the birds that eat the small animals along the river start to come again. And then it started a chain of changes. And some parts in the river, they change the rivers. And this is a kind of thing that nobody can predict. And this is a big, huge network. And biologists are interested in these networks. How can we predict some behaviors? How can we understand these connections? Okay? So let's get a specific kind of network, which is the food web. Okay? So the food web is the idea that we have some trophic levels, right? In the bottom we have like plants, and we can have herbivores and carnivores in several levels, right? Okay. So we can model these things like a network. And the question again is this network handled? I mean, if I am, for example, a fish, or if I am a plant, the probability of someone eats me, okay, is the same of other plants. Okay, so there are several plants available, right? But usually herbivores eat not all, just some of them, right? So what's the probability, if I am a plant, what's the probability of some herbivore to eat me? So if we put the problem in the same way we did in social connections, the same way, the question is, are the possibility of being eaten by someone random, based on some randomly characters, and what the biologists found, they are not random. So what do you see? For example, let's consider what they call trophic levels. The first thing is, when you see the trophic levels, you can see there are plants, for example, and there are some insects. If you are looking on insects, this is an interesting paper about insects. So they eat the plants, so let's say they are herbivores, right? Okay. But then there are some spiders that eat these guys, right? But there is a problem there, that because sometimes the spiders eat other spiders. So they can eat both another spider or the herbivore. So it becomes kind of a network of possible who eats who. Okay? And what they find here, which is interesting, we have something like small patterns that will go together to form a bigger network. So we call these in complex network motifs. Okay, and motifs is highly studied in complex networks because they serve, for example, to predict something. Let's show you a simplest motif. which is, if I have two friends, okay, so I have friend one and friend two, they are both friends, but they are not friends from each other. There is a high probability that they become friends, okay, so we call close the triangle, okay. And this motive, we have two guys and to close the triangle, is a highly recurrent motive in several networks, not just in social relations, in several networks. And this is motive, and we can find them, we can predict them. So here we have motives and ecological networks, in food web networks. Can we study them to understand these networks? Yes, because they are not handily wired. But there is more, there is more. Let's say the rich get richer. Okay, so the thing is, if you see there, three levels, okay? This is a paper, interesting paper, of Thomas Levinson, which is a biologist here at Unicamp, showing, for example, we have three levels here. We have plants, herbivores, and carnivores, okay? And they show who eats who, okay? And then you see that there are some plants that many of the herbivores eat, right? The left one is the everybody eats this plant almost, right? And there are some plants that just two eat them, right? So the distribution of who eats who is not regular, is not random-like. There are plants, as you can see in this graph here, there are plants that are eating a lot. And there are plants that just some eats. And this is something that similar to the idea of complex networks as we see in social relations. And consider that I found a new herbivore that I don't know yet. And I want to predict which plant this new herbivore will eat. There is a high probability of this herbivore eat the first one there. Because it has more connections. So it's the same idea of the social relationships. If it has more connections, probably you get it much more. This is a complex network. And people study that, for example, in freshwater food web, you can, for example, predict in the food web. You can see these connections, and you see that there is some fishes that eaten a lot, and other not much, and so on and so forth. Complex networks has something also, the behavior we call emergence. Who knows what is emergence or emergent behavior? Who knows that? Just one? Okay, just the biologist. Good. We must learn that on computer science because you use that a lot. So, the idea of emergence is we try to study patterns in larger entities that arise, and this arise is the interesting thing, in complex network, arise through interactions among smaller or simple entities. Is that okay? That themselves do not exhibit such properties. So this is the interesting thing, complex networks, because they are networks. So you cannot just get one animal, just one plant, and try to predict something looking on the individual, okay? And you must have guys connected, and when they are connected, it will emerge some kind of behavior, okay, from this network. And several people try to predict that, which kinds of things will emerge. Why, for example, someone put some video on the YouTube and for some reason, some strange reason, everybody starts to look on this video. What's the thing? I mean, it's just because the video, or there is some patterns in the network, in the way it started, so how people start to look and spread it, that exploded. Okay, people study that a lot, and there are some patterns, interesting patterns on that. So the idea is the entity, the emergent property, arises from the smaller one, but you cannot reduce. They are irreductible. I mean, you cannot just try to tell, okay, I know that because I can see the individual. No. It's just putting everything together that you can analyze. So there are several challenges in the analysis of complex networks because this emergent, and you talk a bit about that. So, and the emergence is really interesting. There is, in my YouTube channel, there is a video where I show several emergent behavior things, like, for example, if you see the flocks of snow, they are crystals like that, and why they are like that is an emergent thing. There is no one that plans, okay, we'll be there like that. No, it's an emergent thing. And you see flocks of birds, and you may imagine, okay, this flocks of birds goes that because someone is leading the thing. There is no leader. They just go, and there is a behavior like each bird looks the near bird, and they behave with someone, and the flock appears like just one thing going together. And this is an emergent behavior. I have a video, an entire talk, just talking about emergent behavior. So if someone wants to go deep in this subject, you can go in my YouTube channel and you see a video about this. Okay? And in my research, I was interested in emergence in social networks. In fact, was the first work I did in complex networks with a student here at Unicamp. And what we look at? We look at that. Imagine that you have these sites where people tag images, like Flickr, for example, people put tags on images, okay? So this is a network where you have people, tags, and images, and you can produce a network, okay? And what is the interesting thing we started to look? So I will not go deep also in this topic, but I have another talk in the YouTube where I go deep on this thing. The emergent talk, I go deep in this topic, so you can go there to look how it works. So the idea is, you can get these tags that people put on the things, and look on concurrence, and you can find taxonomies of things. You can see that just as an emergent thing, as just getting, because each person who is putting the tag is not thinking about some kind of taxonomy, okay? It emerges. And you can find these patterns looking, produce networks, and there are several words that can produce even a tree, a taxonomic tree, just analyzing these things. And also because there is another thing that you can see how much some term is related to the image based on the how many people use the same tag. So for example, if you look on this thing, Blackie, Cat, Kitty, and so on, you will see that there are some terms that Canon, for example. Canon is the camera that someone uses to the cat, right? But if you look the how much people reuse the same tags for the same thing, you can see that cat is the most related term with the image. So this will help you to produce the network. And what my student did, he extracted from social networks this kind of latent semantics and used these semantics to feed an ontology, okay? This the work is focused on optimizing ontology, to improve and to analyze the ontology. For example, this is the software he implemented. This was Hugo, okay? He was a master student. So what he implemented, for example, here is a graph from an ontology we call WordNet, okay? And in this ontology, they have Christian and they have Bible, okay? And the thing is, Christian and Bible are two highly connected terms, right? But in the WordNet, they are not connected. So when Hugo got the data from that social network, they are highly connected, right? Because people that will tag Christian will tag Bible, usually. Okay, so they are highly connected. And then you can use this data to go back to the ontology and say, okay, there are something missing here. Because they must be connected, because they are highly connected in the social network. So this is the interesting thing. So, when you look for complex networks, you see there are non-trivial topological features. But which features are that? So, one thing is, they are not purely regular, okay? You cannot explain them like purely regular, like, for example, a lattice, you know? When you connect everything to everything, or you have some pattern on all the network. But they are not purely random. They are not random, okay? They have two important properties we call scale-free and small-world. And what is scale-free? The scale-free is the thing that I already introduced. The idea is the following. If some node has a lot of connections, there is what we call preferential attachment. The idea is, if you have a lot of connections, the probability to get more connections is high. At the end, instead of a normal distribution, what do you have? You have a small number of nodes with a lot of connections, okay? And a lot of nodes with almost nothing connections. Okay, so this is what we call power law. And we see that in several real-world networks, social networks are like that. There are, for example, famous people and so on that has a lot of connections. And most of the people is like that. There is almost no connections. So this is the social networks, but is also several ecological networks, but physical networks also, and several other networks you can see on the world, they behave like that. A second interesting thing is what we call the small world, okay? And the small world is the following. I don't know if you know the classic work of 6 degrees of separation, okay? Which is the first person that talked about that was hypothetically in a novel, which is Fritz Carinthy, which is the following. In the novel, he tells, if I want to reach someone, okay, so let's consider that I was starting with me and want to reach any person in the earth. Any person, okay? So the thing is, I imagine some person, you can tell anyone, okay, for me. So, for example, someone who works in the, I don't know, in some store in India, some place in India, for example. Okay. Can I reach this person? Yes, I can. But who? So now I want to send some letter for this person, but not by mail, okay? I want to send some letter, giving this letter to someone, and this person you send to another person, which you send to another person until it achieves the target. Okay? This is the idea. But the thing is, if I want to send something to India, I try to think, who is the person I know? Who most probably will achieve this person in here. I don't know who is this person, but who is the person I know? So I try, for example, someone who is in, came from India, for example, or someone who is nearby India, or someone who has international relations or something like that, right? And this person will do the same and the same. And what, and so, Stanley Milgram in 67 tested exactly that. He did exactly this experiment. He selected one person in the United States and sent message by mail to several persons, some kind of, not, now they know that it's not all random, but let's say almost random persons. He sent this letter explaining the experiment. Okay, so the experiment is, this is a scientific experiment and so on and so forth. I want you send a letter for this person. But since you don't know this person, try to find someone you know, okay? And send a letter to this person, so, okay? So, at the end, some correspondence were lost and other things, but at the end, he found that to achieve the target will be 6 degrees. I mean, you in 6 persons you achieve this person. So he started the first theory that we can achieve any person in the world, let's say, with 6 degrees of separation. And in that epoch is not so strong hypothesis, but people tested that several times, even in Facebook. Okay, and they achieved, for example, same in Facebook, similar results. Okay, so for example, if I want to meet, to achieve anyone, if you get 6, in Facebook is different the number. I don't know if it's higher or lower. I think it's a bit lower. But let's say it's 6, let's say. So if I have, I follow 6 friend links, I will achieve anyone in the world. And this is amazing, because you may imagine that Facebook has billions of persons, okay? But what people found, complex networks are all like that. I mean, if you get, for example, the neurons on your brain, okay? Get the neurons on your brain, and you have connections, right? And you have billions of neurons, right? Okay, and you want to start from one neuron and achieve another neuron in any place of your brain, okay? The number of connections is what we call a small number. It's not like you have billions of neurons, it's not like 100. No, it's not like 100, okay? It's like, I don't know the exact number, but it will be, let's say, 8 or 10 or something. So what we found in complex networks is not just all networks are 6 or 7, doesn't matter the number, but all numbers are small. Small, I mean 6, 7, 8, 10, even the biggest network. So this is amazing. I can achieve anything. And there is several interesting things you can conclude by that, okay? In this way, it's possible from one point to quickly achieve another point, right? And for example, if you have, I'll talk a bit later, the complex networks, they show the complex networks, they are highly resistant to random attacks. What is random attack? Consider that some neuron in your brain dies. Okay, some neuron dies. What's the probability that your brain stops work? Okay, it's low. Why is low? Because it's a complex network, and most of your neurons, there are almost no connections. It's a smaller number of connections. So the probability to get these neurons is really, really high. So probably if some neuron dies, it's just a neuron that has no much connections. The probability of getting these neurons that has a lot of connections is too small. And not just in complex networks. In all kinds of complex networks, so you see, is the same thing. If you have a, what we call a random attack, random, I will not choose one, I just attack someone. It's highly resistant because the probability to get some node is high. Okay? But it's not resistant for what? What do you think the complex network is really, really, really weak or really, really, how can I say, fragile? What do you think? Which kind of attack is really bad for a complex network? You can imagine? Consider you have some kind of network, okay? Let's say internet is a complex network. Okay? Internet is a complex network. I have some nodes that has a lot of connections, right? Some servers or some hubs or something, okay? And most of them have a small number of connections. Do you agree? Internet is a complex network. So I want to attack the internet. I can consider that a random attack. What will be a random attack? I will get all of these nodes of the internet and randomly select one and attack it. What is the probability of the internet to suffer something? Probably with some users somewhere, right? It do nothing in the internet. Okay. But which kind of attack could cause highly problems to the internet? What do you think? What? If? Okay, if you select some node with a lot of connections. So, it's weak when you select the node you want to attack. Because I can attack the node that I want. If I will select, I select this one, right? So, for example, complex networks are highly resistant to disasters, for example, because the disasters attack head-on things, right? But it's not good for security, because in security, you must protect these guys here, otherwise they will attack these guys and the network can collapse. With if you get two or three nodes, it collapses, for example. Okay? There are several network complex network examples. You can get complex networks for physical relationships like neurons, connections, force relationships like in physics and so on, social relationships, conceptual relationships. Huh? Okay. So, for example, several people use complex networks to study contagion, spread of disease, for example. People study that. And it's important to do predictions, to analyze the network, and those things like that. People study complex networks, for example, to analyze the interaction of proteins. Okay? Because interaction of proteins is everything in your body, everything. If you want to know why some virus can attach in the surface of a cell, it is interaction of proteins. Okay? Why some product produces some reaction in you. Interaction of proteins. So, proteins are the building blocks of your body. And if you want to analyze how things work in your body, you analyze interaction proteins. And this is a complex network and has the same properties I told you. Transportation airlines. So, what happened? Since people start to see they have these common properties, we can start to develop algorithms that can be applied to several of these networks. And some algorithms that, for example, I developed for social science, I can apply for health or for another things I want, bioecology or someone. OK? of some, or anything else. So what started to follow there is a convergence. People start to tell, okay, we can produce a kind of network science. So the idea is the network is a science that we can study and we can develop algorithms. So let's talk about this convergence. For example, there are three kinds of convergence I see. There is a convergence of problem abstraction that I told you, okay, is how you see the problem as a network. But there is also convergence of approach to face the problem, I will show you. And there are convergence of measurements that I will show also. So let's talk about the convergence of problem abstract is the thing I showed until now. You can get networks of sociology, biology, also the web, the internet is a network that people use as a complex network. Okay? So everything is a graph. And when you talk everything is a graph, you can do as analysis. For example, in this case, I'm looking for clusters. And this is an interesting study a student did, Celso did, which is not a study. He just applied some algorithm just to show as example. This is a Facebook network, okay? And what is the nodes are people on the Facebook. What is the edges are the friend relations, okay? And he executed an algorithm that found the clusters, but the algorithm doesn't know who is the nodes and who is the persons. The clusters are found just looking the connections, just analyzing who is connected, just that. And then he looked at the results and told, okay, in fact, these persons here are persons I know, for example, from school. This person is from, I lived abroad some years, and this person I know from that. So you see, this is an interesting thing. I can find things just looking what we call topology. What is topology? Topology is the specific way in which the network is arranged. And I can find things. And also the dynamics. The dynamics is the way the networks evolves along the time, how it changes along the time. And then it started a convergence, what we call approaches, areas of study. For example, there is an area we call link prediction. And what's the link prediction? I will try to predict the next link in the network. It can be used, for example, for recommendation. You can imagine that the videos you like, the videos you see, the people you know, is a network. And the system can analyze the network to predict, okay, this guy will like to see this video in the future. Like Amazon trying to see which book you will buy next, okay? So the thing is, you can use that to predict links in the network. You can predict several things. So if we are talking about protein interactions, analyzing the network, I can predict this. There are two interpretations of prediction. One interpretation is, I want to predict the future state. Okay, because, for example, I want to predict that some person will become friend of some person. Or I want to predict that, for example, you like to see some video. But prediction can be something from the present state. It's something I don't know, but I want to predict that it probably will be there. For example, in proteins interaction, they use link prediction to consider probably these two proteins interact. Probably. And then we can go to the lab and study it. Okay? Spreading and diffusion. So epidemics is an area, and there are several algorithms that try to analyze and simulate epidemics and these things. Robustness, which is the behavior when you destroy some nodes, for example. There are the clustering sim. So I want to know, find communities, how they behave, how they evolve, and so on and so forth. So link prediction is an area, also I told you. And then people start to converge what we call measurements. So what is measurement? I will show you one measurement and come back to this slide. So let's talk about node centrality, what we call centrality in a network. Consider these rows here, okay? Okay? Now, I want to ask you a question, so pay attention, okay? Considering any point here, okay? Any point? And you start randomly walk. You start to walk randomly. Walk, okay? And I will take several pictures of you walking in these streets, okay? And consider you a kind of robot. You are not a human. You are a robot, so you walk randomly in this area like for a week, okay? At the end, I try to analyze in which place in this map you went more times. What do you think? You pathed or you walked through more times. Which place in this map do you think? Which place? What? Castello there, in the middle, right? And why? Everything goes there, it's more connected, right? It's not just more connected, but the place that connected is also connected a lot, right? It's the thing that I showed you in the beginning, right? So it's not just it is connected, but are big roads. So the roads that are connected to it are highly connected also. So we can tell this node is a central node, but we need something to measure that. And one interesting measure we call page rank. I don't know if you know page rank, but page rank is an algorithm developed by Google. Okay? And this algorithm tells the following. If someone points to me, I receive some score. If I have a lot of connections, I receive some score, right? But not just that. Not just that. Because sometimes, like this A node here, this yellow node, he receives a lot of connections, you see, as the red one, but these guys are not so connected, they're not so important. So I want to come to analyze two things. The number of connections I receive, but also the importance of the nodes that points to me. And how I analyze the importance of the nodes that points to me? Recursively analyzing the same thing. How many nodes point to them? And how the importance of the nodes that point to them? And it's recursively again and again and again. So this is not a trivial algorithm. It tries to compute until convergence and finds, for example, B is the most central in some kinds. Central could be more important or more accessible, depends on the case. So Google does that to analyze the importance of a page. Okay? And Google showed this is really effective, right? Because it finds the page you are looking for. So it shows that, in fact, just looking the network, you can find node centrality. So this is one of measures. So several people developed algorithms to analyze node centrality. And you can use it not just for web pages. You can use for all the problems I showed you. For example, I will show you, we developed it in our lab an experiment. Applying PageRank to fishes to see who is the most central fish in the food chain, for example. Okay? And this is an important information because is the answer for the thing I showed in the beginning. Is some fish that several other fish eat, that in recursively others eat, it's important fish in the food chain. And there is a high impact if he, for example, is extinct, for example. This is the experiment. So this is a graph of a student, a master student, Patricia, that she got, and also Vitor is not here, but they got data from fish-based database, which is the one of the biggest or the biggest database of fishes in the world, and they have information about food chains, and they produce the graph, and a page rank shows that the node there is one of the most important fishes, more central fishes, because several other fishes eat it. It's not the best graph. I have another one, but I don't know where I put it, because it shows not just this guy. If you zoom in, you see other important guys also, okay? But this is an interesting thing. So to show you that you can use the same method, PageRank, and people use PageRank for several things. Several in sociology, to see centrality of a person, in physics or in proteins, to see what's the important central protein in your body, and so on. It's the same algorithm, okay? So, if we have this convergence of problems, approaches, and methods, can we think in a common solution, in a common framework? Because what happens is, people that does research in this area do each one produce an entire solution for the problem from scratch usually, or there are some toolkits that solve parts of the problems. But since this problem is convergent, can we think in a convergence of a framework, a solution, an infrastructure? And this is the main topic we are looking in our lab, which is a kind of, I'm trying to put together several research, several works around complex network, around this infrastructure. So I show you the idea is the basic. The basic idea is the form. First, we have external source to analyze. So imagine I want to produce a frame, an infrastructure which is general. It's not for a specific problem, even though we are working mostly in biology, but we have other areas also. But so consider I have external sources. Usually you start from external sources, okay? And you want to analyze them. So usually you want to produce a graph. Our proposal is we must have a graph database in the middle, okay? To transform everything in a graph, and then we can analyze it, okay? After that, we need to have tools to process queries, okay, to do network analysis, to manage aspects of the analysis, for example, versioning of the network, layers, I will show you, or several other aspects of the network, okay, and applications. So this is the big picture, and I will show you now some research of students inside this big picture here. And they are not, some of them are not conceived in the beginning to interact. We are now getting the big picture, and we are now working to put them together, okay? So, for example, one research that we started was a student, Eduardo, that get data from external database describing living beings and transformed it in a graph to do network analysis on it. So the idea is starting from what we call data spaces. The idea we have several data sources. We want to import them in a graph and in some way link them and analyze them. So I have a student who is now in England, working on the thing, which started to think, okay, one of the big sources of information are spreadsheets, okay? So how we can, for example, this is Evie. Evie is the student who works in this topic. So she analyzed the following. Can we automatically capture the structure of a spreadsheet, analyze it, and transform it in a graph and put it in our database? So this is an important aspect, okay? EV is not just looking to transform in a graph, but also in semantics. This graph has some semantics, but I will not enter in this specific aspect now. I have some lectures you can, some talks you can see on the web about the thing. But the idea is it goes to the graph. And we show it that we can do some analysis on this graph when it's in a graph database. We combine the information of several spreadsheets, I don't know if it was 1,000 or something like that. And this is a software that is in the web available, when you can see how we combine data from several spreadsheets, put them together, and you can look on them, and so on and so forth. This is again, sorry, the order is not so good, but this is again the work of Eduardo, who imported several data from living beings in a graph, and we start to produce algorithms, not just to put the things in a graph, but also to connect the data, to find connections, so we have what we call entity resolution. We want to see which node is equivalent to which node, and produce one single graph, and then we can do analysis on that. So you may imagine the following. Okay, you want to analyze complex networks, right? But the networks come from data outside, but they are not usually so prepared, so ready to be analyzed, right? You need to prepare the data, find connections, produce the things, and this was the first step to do this thing also. And now I have a work of a student, Patricia, who is finishing her master and starting her PhD now, regraph. And the idea is try to put this thing in a single thing. The idea is the following: get data from a relational database and transform in a graph. Sorry, when I import the thing, the arrows went like crazy. But the idea is the following: we start from a relational database, and it goes. We have a mapping definition, and this mapping definition maps the relational database to a graph. And then you can have a graph viewer to see if the mapping is okay, your graph is okay. And then you have a module that you get all the data of the database and put as in a graph model based in your mapping. Okay? After that, there is a synchronization mechanism. If you do some update in the relational database, it updates in the graph. Okay? It's a one-way synchronization, in the sense that it doesn't do the opposite. Just if you update the relational, it updates the graph. And there is an annotation module that enriches the graph with things. For example, if you find in some graph, you run a page rank algorithm, you want to store that in the graph. This is an annotation, okay? So it can annotate the graph, and it also link with external graphs, like DBpedia. There is another student, Luana, who is looking for how to get data from biological sources. We call, for example, model organism databases, and how to convert them in graphs so we can do graph analysis. Another student, Fagner, has the following problem. A lot of data in relational databases are texts, okay, are textual. How can we extract data from these texts, convert them to a graph, connect them to ontologies, okay, and produce a semantic graph from the texts, okay? Because sometimes your data is not in a graph format, it's texts, okay? So when you have texts, it's hard, right? So the idea is, can we convert texts in graphs in such a way that in such a way that we can use this graph to do the analysis. So Fagner is focused on that. He's using a bit of natural language processing here. He's trying to connect this graph to ontologies. And there is a new student, Francisco, who is probably working also in this direction of texts and data mining technique. No, information retrieval techniques also and graphs. We are looking in this direction because a lot of data we are interested, like biological data. In this case, Fagner got biological descriptions of living beings. They are as texts. Okay, so if we can do that automatically, it will be highly interesting. The next is the Celso. Celso is a student who brought this topic of complex network for our lab. He was the first student. He is a PhD student. He is finishing his PhD now. And the first thing, this graph is from his research. So most of the idea of thinking in this way about putting the things together is started with Celso, and he considered the following. The standard way to do application, to develop things in complex networks is like, you read everything in the memory, and you process everything, and you produce results, and if the things doesn't fit in the memory, it's a problem, it's hard to materialize the results, and so on and so forth. So he proposed this idea of, can we think in a database perspective of analysis of complex networks. So he proposed a workflow in which you load data, okay, and then you produce this graph database and you can then manipulate it and analyze it, but base it on queries. And this is one interesting thing. This is, I think, is a highly interesting topic, because what he considered. Okay, if we have common metrics, if we have common things, can we put them in a query language? Can we query things? For example, let's consider the page rank. Okay, I want to query things and organize them by the page rank. Okay, order by page rank. Can we do that? So he started to look in this query language, and the idea is, try to get some GraphQL query language and extend it to write sentences of complex network analysis. Okay, so for example, return nearby restaurants ranked by distance from my positions. Okay, so the thing, this query can go to the graph and get analyze the connections in georelevance. But then, what happened here? Why? Just the same slide several times? Oh God, I think I did some ugly cut and paste. Okay, but there are other, this query language, you can add other sentences and mix them together. So it's a kind of way that you can use a query language to do all the analysis. So you don't need to develop software to write code, several lines of code to analyze something. He developed this idea. And to develop this idea, he developed the idea of graph-based aggregation. So he considers these metrics like a kind of aggregation you do in a graph. And so, for example, if you want to get something like centrality, you start from a node, and you look at from the neighbors, and the neighbors of the neighbors, and based on this thing, you can consider the centrality of this node. For this reason, we think this is similar to the thing we do in aggregation, and this is a kind of graph aggregation. So he developed an algebra, okay, to develop this algebra, he did a kind of parallel between graphs and a relational model. And based on this parallel, he developed an algebra. So you can express the metrics, the measurements of complex networks in this algebra to use in his language. So what is the message here? The message here is, at the end, we are expecting that the user, who can be, for example, some guy that's doing a research, he can write some sentence like you do in SQL, and the system will return things ranked, analyzed, and so on. So you can prototype things, you can test things, you can go and go back and forth to analyze the complex network. I have another student who is Felipe. He started 6 months ago. He's now in Spain doing a master sandwich research. And he is looking for connections between, in this case, he's looking Twitter networks. So the idea is the following. Link prediction, as I told you, is a hot topic. I want to predict the next state of a network. So for example, Twitter is a network because people on Twitter, they follow other people, right? So this is a network of follow. So you may imagine that they follow, but they also tweet. And this tweet and retweet is information that flows through the network. You can see it's like a first layer here. Oh, sorry. The first layer is the network, the follow network, okay? And the other layers are tweets and retweets of messages, okay? And what the Felipe is thinking, can we, the information influences the next state of the network. So for example, if I'm a guy that retweets too much, not important things, probably people will stop following me because I will be like a spammer. Okay? So can we analyze these things, predict these things? And to do that, we must develop in our infrastructure a way to devise layers in the complex network. So this is another thing we are looking for. There are versions. So Ricardo is a student who is looking on versions. Consider that we want to look, for example, the dynamics of the network. How the network evolves along the time. We want to have several versions of graphs in the network, in the graph database. And there is no standard for versioning graphs. So can we version that? So versions can be modifications along the time, but can also be layers, as we saw before. So idea of versions is, can we split the graph in several different alternative versions or versions that evolve along the time? This is Ricardo is working on that. And I have also, so Ricardo is a master student. And there is also Mateus, who is a PhD student, who is working in the what we call multi-scale graphs. So the graphs are usually huge. And if you want to look or analyze information, it will be interesting if we can consider layers like zoom in and zoom out in the information. Not the geographically speaking, but the information. So how we do that, and this is a topic that Mateus is looking. So I hope I didn't this is not all the students, this is the student that worked on this previous version of this slide. But I hope that I didn't forget some students here, but the idea is let me go back to the wall architecture. So the idea is try to converge. For example, now we are working in an important database. The name is Fishbase. OK? okay? We have a collaboration, and the idea is we are converting the fish base to a graph database. We call fish graph. And we are working, there are several students working on that, to produce a first-class graph database with information about fishes around the world. Because on that, we can do several network analysis about fish behavior, fish food networks, fish environment, and everything. Okay? And the idea is to produce this network not just to have important information, but our experiment could be reproducible, okay? And also, another important thing is we can have a standard model which other biological or biodiversity information systems can reproduce and do analysis in the same way, okay? So, this is the thing. Oh, thank you very much. Let me see if there's something missing. No. So there are some references here, and this is my webpage. If you need more information, as I told you, I have a YouTube channel, and you can achieve that from my page, and there are several videos about several things I talked here. There is, for example, a class about PageRank, explaining how it works, okay? There is several classes about emergence, several things I talked here. I have videos deeply going these topics, okay? Well, thank you very much. Questions? Okay. No questions?
Obrigado, André.
Okay, thank you.